50.
Welcome, Robbie, to the AMA. Thanks for joining us on such short notice.
Yeah, thanks, Jack. Excited to be here.
So let's just get into the thick of it already and kick off with the partnership with GameStop. A lot of the questions focused on why Immutable X chose GameStop and vice versa. So what was it about GameStop that made them the partner of choice?
Yeah, so obviously Immutable X powers and works with many, many different marketplaces. At the moment, we're doing our integration with OpenSea and talking with most of the major marketplaces around the world. But GameStop is such a massive player and powerful entrant into the Web3 space from Web2. And the reasons behind that is a few. The first is they have a huge piece of cultural heritage in gaming and 50 million customers associated with that. The second thing is you guys, the massive evangelistic fan base that is one of the most powerful in the world right now, that are all, you know, moving to whatever GameStop does as the next product, which I think makes GameStop's position as entering the Web3 space, which is fundamentally about aligning consumer incentives and coordinating things in a much better way than traditionally exploitative like company consumer relationships, a very, very good move for GameStop. And finally, we're just really excited about the team they've built. They've built an incredibly credible NFT marketplace team, pulling people from crypto native organizations in the space. They are staffing this very heavily, and they are very, very genuine about the roadmap they're building out. So on basically all three fronts, we're thrilled to work with GameStop to make the premier NFT gaming marketplace.
Awesome. So let's switch it around right at the inverse. Why did GameStop choose you guys, and what do you actually bring to the table? And yep, what's the vision? Tell us.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, GameStop wants gaming content, and that is what Immutable X as a company is currently really focused on in NFTs, is long-term, high utility games. You want to actually give players true ownership and kind of create a much better relationship between player and consumer. And so as Immutable, we are bringing all of that content to them and literally working on them with sort of pitches even. I think the other thing is the technical side of Immutable, where the platform that we've built is specifically designed to onboard mainstream Web2 companies into NFTs. If you ask a developer to use smart contracts to start building something, you've limited your pool of developers to literally 50,000 people in the world. And it is heinous to build smart contracts. It's incredibly risky, as we just saw with the $300 million wormhole hack like 2 days ago. What we are is completely API based, which means any Web2 developer, and there are hundreds of millions of them, can build on us. We can do integrations with gaming SDKs, which we're currently working on. We can make it really, really simple for mainstream developers to do what they do best, which is build high quality games while we take care of creating a frictionless experience for people to own and trade the items inside of those games, inside that game, and inside the marketplace of GameStop as well.
Okay, gotcha. I think the announcement came out as a bit of a surprise for us, and we'll get more into the details later about what Immutable X is in more detail. But at a high level, could you tell us what Immutable is? What do you do?
Yeah, of course. So I've been in blockchain for a while, since 2014. I kind of liked Bitcoin. I thought it was cool. I became obsessed with Ethereum, and that's because I could actually build on it. And I remember using a dApp, some of you may be familiar with it, called Etherroll back in the day, which was very, very simply gambling contract. You roll a die and you can bet, you know, above or below a certain amount, and it returns you probabilistically based on expected value. And I'm not a big fan of gambling at all, but the reason I found this magical was in 80 lines of code, they had made redundant what governments spend tens of billions of dollars every single year doing, enforcing compliant payouts, transparent probabilities. And they did something that governments could never do, which is make the middleman redundant and instead give profits to every single community owner of this platform. And I thought, if someone did that in 80 lines of code, obviously the entire world is going to run on this stuff. It may take a decade, it may take 2 decades, but eventually we're just going to be using smart contracts as the back end for everything. And you won't even know that you're using them. And so we became obsessed, we started building. And really what we've built today is Immutable, which has a couple of prongs to it. So the fundamental thing we built is an NFT platform that allows businesses to very, very simply create NFT businesses. They can use APIs that are simple. They're like Stripe to use. They're completely carbon neutral. They are gas free. So end users pay $0 for creating or trading an NFT. And that's really crucial for games, right? Because if you're World of Warcraft and you're creating 100 million NFTs a day, you actually have to have zero cost associated with the creation of that NFT. And as far as I'm aware, we are the only platform that offers that to developers right now, because we pay for those costs and we roll them up into zero knowledge proofs, which make them incredibly, incredibly efficient for us to create, essentially. And we can do that at scale. We also have a bunch of internal content, which is really exciting. So we have, I think, the second largest blockchain game in the world right now, Gods Unchained, by players. And the vision of that has always been, how do we create a mainstream game that sells itself not on the label NFT? Because I think that if you have to sell a game by saying it has NFTs, it's like selling a website by saying it uses HTTPS. Like it's absurd. It's, you know, adjunct to the value proposition. What it should really be is players experience the value of being able to trade and own their assets. Players experience the value of having real guarantees over their economy. And that's what GU has always aimed to be, a mainstream trading card game where you can own your cards like you do Magic the Gathering or Yu-Gi-Oh cards if you buy them in real life. And we also have a mobile RPG, Guild of Guardians, which we're working on, which is designed for the exact same thing, to take this to the mainstream. We're 154 people full-time right now, and we're growing to 350 people this year. So please come apply if you're interested in working in NFTs. And we've done deals with the biggest people in the space, which I think has really added to our credibility. So we launched our partnership with TikTok to launch their first ever NFTs a few months ago. We're working with Vivi, who's doing Disney and Marvel's NFTs. We're working with Ember Sword, which is one of the biggest blockchain games right now. Alluvium, which has a $5 billion token. Green Park Sports by the co-founder of YouTube and Zappos. And many, many more to come. So that's a bit about what we've built today and where we're going.
Awesome. That's great to hear. So touching on the kind of elephant in the room, another layer two company, what's happening with other companies like Loopring?
Yeah, look, we definitely can't comment on Loopring directly. What we can say is that many marketplace front ends end up supporting a variety of blockchain and L2s, for instance, like ETH L1 as Ethereum. Ultimately, though, what matters is where the NFTs are actually minted and traded. And this is what Immutable specializes in. GameStop and Immutable are literally building the perfect platform for onboarding gaming customers and their NFTs, and then literally getting on calls together to win these customers. We have some scheduled for next week. So Immutable is essentially a backend for NFT projects and marketplaces. We will work with many different marketplaces. We're currently integrating with OpenSea and trading experiences. And our vision for what the future of trading is actually going to look like is quite unique to our product strategy. So something you may not know about Immutable is we're not just a scaling solution, but we are also the global order book by which marketplaces and games are powered. And the reason this is so powerful is, for instance, you could list an asset on GameStop's marketplace. And because our order book is shared, you could then buy that item inside a game like Gods Unchained or Fortnite if they ended up supporting IMX. Inside that game's context. The corollary is you could be in Fortnite, earn a skin, which is a John Wick skin, and sell it directly in the game's context, removing any friction for the end user, and directly purchase it off any IMX supported marketplace like GameStop. So the goal really is fundamentally, how do we let players trade from anywhere in a frictionless experience and use major partnerships like GameStop to kind of funnel a huge amount of distribution to these partners. This is a unique product in this space. We have the best platform for NFT games, and we're going to make the assets from those games available to everyone on the GameStop NFT marketplace, which I think is really, really important.
Yeah. So I think people are actually pretty interested on, you know, who actually made the pitch to who. Was it you reaching out to GameStop or vice versa?
Yeah, look, GameStop hired crypto native people in the space. I personally knew a lot of those people, and they day one reached out to me as soon as they started on the project. So we've been in conversations for a very long time with GameStop.
Okay. How long has been a very long time?
The better half of a year.
Yeah, okay. That makes sense. So what's the actual impact been since the announcement? I imagine it's been pretty crazy the past few days.
Absolutely insane. So for a reference point, we launched TikTok 4 months ago, which was probably the biggest partnership the company has announced. Obviously, one of the largest social media companies in the world. And there was an enormous amount of buzz around that. They literally bought out the back page of the New York Times and had, you know, billboards in Times Square. And this has been bigger than that by an order of magnitude in terms of the community response. We've seen, you know, thousands of developers applying to the forms already. We've had an overwhelming response from people, games developers and CEOs and consumers alike. So we're really thrilled. And a large part of the goal of what we're building is to mean that, you know, thousands and thousands of customers can't be handheld through building a game. They have to use a product that is simply ready to go. And the stat that I'm proudest about Immutable is the platform we've built makes it ridiculously easy for anyone to build self-service. In fact, we've had the numbers of self-service platforms building on our testing environment go from 170 on November 1st to 1,100 today. So like quadrupling in 3 months. And that product means that GameStop, as this massive faucet of distribution, can have these people start building and distributing via GameStop's marketplace ridiculously simply. We're not constrained by the amount of people we have or the speed at which our team can operate. We can literally cater to thousands of developers simultaneously.
Awesome. So going back to the SEC filings that GameStop placed, so it said that Immutable X would help GameStop NFT marketplace be an ecosystem for developers and independent AAA alike, rather. So can you expand on what's actually meant by this?
Yeah. So the goal really is, I'm actually most bullish over the next 2 years on mid-market game studios. And by this, I mean value between 50 mil to $1 billion, with maybe, you know, a couple of million players. And that's because they're the ones who are going to go all in on NFTs as a strategy to make their game much, much better. They are, you know, much less monopolistic than incumbents, which means they're going to be much more happy to iterate or experiment with play to earn, with actually rewarding players instead of just trying to extract marginal dollars on, you know, a deck collection in a card game. So by catering to both, it's really, hey, we can create a brilliant experience with AAA games, and we should and will onboard those. But this is also about bringing the power to the players for, you know, hundreds of millions of consumers to access any game who wants to use the power of NFTs, and kind of connecting GameStop's audience with these games who want to find the growth that allows them to compete with the biggest companies in the world.
Yeah. And will there be any interaction between, you know, GameStop and IMAX's Gods Unchained brand, or is it just something separate totally?
Of course. So as I said before, any NFT on Immutable X is traded everywhere. So as soon as GameStop launches, it has access to the assets on every single one of the games have already launched. Any Gods Unchained card will be able to be traded or purchased on GameStop, and we look forward to that. As to deeper integrations, we'll keep you posted.
Okay, cool. So also a part of the SEC filings were grant milestones. So having completed what looks to be the first two, most recently the initial PR announcement, this has resulted in, you know, a cumulative total of about 37 million IMX tokens being granted to GameStop. So could you talk to me about that big upfront token grant?
Yeah, of course. Building great things takes big investments. We're thrilled about the marketplace. It's going to be a huge play in the gaming space, and that requires massive capital outlay in terms of staff, in terms of product, marketing, and business development teams. GameStop and Immutable have been investing resources in building out our teams and this product even before this partnership was announced. As I said, we've been in talks for quite a while. It takes investment to build, and tokens are a great source of funding to build out what is required to win. The goals and further milestones we set collaboratively with GameStop are plain as day in the 8K, and we hope to blow through that $3 billion of GMV in marketplace volume in, you know, in 2 years, and then go way past that. So the ambitions are very, very high. We would not do a partnership unless we thought it would actually redefine NFT gaming of this magnitude. And the final thing I'll say is, like, GameStop is a huge publicly traded company. They're under intense scrutiny by the SEC. They don't make public comments as a matter of policy.
Yeah, we're well aware. So what about the 100 million joint fund? Can you go into a bit more detail about that?
Yeah, of course. So the $100 million joint fund is denominated in Immutable X tokens, and they're not going to be converted into cash. They'll be given away as IMX tokens, and they'll all be in completely vested agreements with milestone earnouts and incentives for these game developers to build something really, really meaningful. In terms of the operations, it's going to be GameStop and Immutable reviewing these deals collaboratively, and we'll be selecting what we think are the best fits. So please, if you know someone, if you are someone who's building an exciting game that you think can redefine player ownership, reach out. We would love to fund you. And you know, we also have massive investment capabilities as Immutable, and we often work with games on an investment basis as well.
Yeah.
The final thing we'll be doing is we're actually building massive services on Immutable side to help these games succeed on GameStop's marketplace. So the thing I always say is we have one of blockchain's biggest games, Gods on Chain, has hundreds of thousands of players. The goal is to take it mainstream. Guild of Guardians has one of the biggest audiences for a crypto game right now. And they both have billion-dollar tokens. And all of the IP that we've invested into these, from tokenomics to play and earn mechanisms to marketing and community, are available to our partners, which we actually find really powerful. Like, one of the main reasons people come and work with us is they're a Web2 company. They want to use NFTs to empower their players rather than exploit them, but they don't know how to do everything from tokenomics to the finer details of like launching even a fundable token. We make all of that really, really simple to access, and that's really important for us.
Yeah. And I think probably one of the largest elephants in the room is that generated a lot of FUD, which would be, why did you delete your tokens after the announcement? I'm sure many people want to hear that answer.
Yeah, so I already posted the answer on Reddit. This is obviously a massive misconception. The only circulating supply increase has been from the planned for tokens allocated to GameStop. Immutable has sold no tokens since the public sale, so since before the tokens went live. And Immutable, for precisely the purposes of long-term alignment, does not issue tokens directly to its employees. We hold on our balance sheet so that we're long-term aligned with the platform. You don't get to be a 162-person, you know, massive company in the crypto space without having a very, very clear, compliant and long-term framework. And, you know, we will continue to stick by that.
And let's move on to more of the product side now. Immutable advertises the fact that it is carbon neutral, which I think is personally great. But what does carbon neutral actually mean in the context of your company, and how did it achieve it?
Yeah, it's a great question. Lots of companies say this. I think it actually matters. Yeah. What is your carbon impact? Not just, hey, I'm paying millions of dollars to offset things by planting a bunch of trees while I'm also burning through a bunch of horrendous fossil fuels. And I think that ESG generally as a concept is kind of maturing to that analysis as well. Yeah. So the fundamental thing is that by using zero knowledge rollups, we limit the carbon footprint of every NFT traded or minted by more than a factor of 1 to 600,000. So this is by far the most carbon efficient out of any solution. And then what we do, we offset. And you can verify that through our audited partners who are Trace, whom we've offset with CO2, and we're fully up to date with that today. So this is actually really important to us for two reasons. One is it's incredibly important to be a carbon neutral brand. But two is we feel like this is a mission driven company, right? It is, how do we empower and reward and take digital ownership to hundreds of millions of users worldwide? And how do we mean that this future is not built on Facebook? The entire world is going to be digital. We may be in a simulation now, but more than likely we'll have simulations or games in a century from now, which feel just as good and people will live in for just as much time as the real world. That requires property rights. That requires guarantees to end users about what they own and what they can do. I sure as shit don't want that to be owned by a major exploitative company. It must be owned by the people. It must be truly decentralized and it must be truly secure. And all of that links back to, we can't leave any reason for the public to not want to use this technology. We have to make it, completely from any negative externality purpose, easy to use. That's just our requirement in order to meet the expectations of the public today. It's the 21st century. We have to shape up.
Yeah, I think that's a great mission. And everyone also loves thinking about the future. So speaking about the future, where do you see the future of your product heading in, say, the next year and 5 years down the line?
It's a great question. So the goal of Immutable is we really see NFTs as being the thing that allows you to own unique stuff. And there's actually way more dollars worth of unique stuff in the world than there is non-unique stuff, pretty much currencies and shares. And even shares in many capacities are unique. You have different classes of stocks or liquidity preferences associated with each share, or even lockups. And each of those requires a unique trade instrument to trade them. And so the way I kind of think about the NFT industry right now is it's like JPEGs if the only reason people use the file format was to do memes. when in fact you have the entire world of photography in front of you and every piece of information that can be contained inside of it. In the same way, gaming is by far the vertical we are most excited about. Like, gamers spend $100 billion on in-game items every year that they don't own and that they can't sell, and they get a very, very raw deal from publishers. I think that's crappy and we should change that. But also, there are other verticals where this would bring massive benefit to people. There are things like financial verticals, where we can tokenize houses or insurance contracts or financial options. There are things like physical goods, like sneakers or literally wine. There's a $5 billion secondary market every year for wine. I mean, hell, the estimated secondary market cap of Magic the Gathering cards is $20 billion. So people want to trade stuff. Mm. And ultimately, NFTs are horrendously mispriced right now as a collectibles asset class. They're going to be how we trade literally everything. And the goal of Immutable is to be the liquidity platform, the back end for any product or marketplace or game or trading application that wants to use NFTs, and to bridge liquidity between each of these, to share orders between each of these on our global order book, which means if you want to sell something from Fortnite, you can buy it in GameStop. You can list an asset for sale in GameStop and have it be bought inside a game by a player looking to play their next match. So 5 years from now, I'd look us, you know, we want to be on that mission. We want to be powering multiple verticals, and we want to be helping to empower consumers on this road to making everything tradable for the best possible price.
Yeah. So let's move on to everyone's favorite topic, which is tokenomics. IMX has a total supply of 2 billion tokens and has a circulating supply of 225 million as of this AMA. Can you explain this concept and how it fits into your strategy to manage inflation and deflation of the token? I think there's a bit of confusion about that, so it'd be great to get a better understanding.
So first off, a clarification. We're going to be giving these, the vast majority of Immutable X tokens, over 60%, are given away to the community in order to incentivize growth and adoption of the Immutable protocol. Mm-hmm. So some of this will be user incentives, and we routinely look at how we're spending these to maximize the growth of the platform. That could be every time you trade, you earn IMX tokens. Every time you deposit or sign up or perform some valuable user action. And the other is business grants and working with businesses to encourage them to adopt our ecosystem. Mm-hmm. If you look at our kind of token schedule, a lot of these are vested. So that 4-year period is generally the vesting cycle for a lot of these tokens. The 10-year period is the much longer. Like, when will we be giving this away? Mm-hmm. For those of you who don't have experience in crypto, the way that it works is that the Immutable X token effectively must be used to pay for a certain percentage of transactions of the platform. So it kind of receives fees from the Immutable platform. And the main goal of the token is to incentivize the growth of that platform. So our job is to make this protocol as large as possible, to make those volumes as large as possible, and to help create as the local, like the global backend for NFTs. So everything we're doing is designed to motivate that growth.
Yeah, that makes sense. So moving more to industry topics, I think people would love to get your understanding and view on the NFT industry and crypto industry as a whole. The biggest resistance to NFTs in the gaming community is the possibility of exploiting players for profits, because video game developers' history of pay to win, loot box gambling, and creating half-built games and further charge and expansion packs. So how can players actually gain trust in an NFT marketplace?
Yeah, I think the first thing is that there is more, we have to build that trust, right? I think I said this on the Bankless podcast. The answer is not talk. The answer is not to say, hey, NFTs are really good for you. They're really shiny. VCs are investing in them. The answer is to make a freaking good game with hundreds of millions of players that doesn't even talk about NFTs. If you go to God's Unchained website, we don't mention the word NFT once. And that's because we think the value should come from your ability to have the guaranteed capacity to sell something later on, your ability to have guarantees over economics and scarcity. And so we actually have to deliver on the value proposition that we're saying. If it's fairer, we have to make fairer games. If it's better for players, we have to give players value. If it's going to make game developers more successful, we have to make games that are more successful than leading games. We've seen the start of this. I mean, I think God's Unchained, for example, is a really, really exciting potential where we've built something that is mainstream competitive. You would play it even if you didn't have to, even if you didn't get the ability to sell these items. And that's kind of where you have to start at a fundamental purpose. You know, it's not play to earn, it's play and earn. And I think a lot of the vision will be simply the benefit is at the end of playing, you know, 5 years in RuneScape or 5 years in Hearthstone, instead of your account as being dead, you can sell your collection to a player who wants to onboard early. I mean, that's kind of the fundamental core concept we're trying to do, is bring property rights from the real world into the digital one.
No, I think the topic of pay to win is quite divisive. But what's your take on, you know, those people who don't have the money? And is it going to be the same playing field once this actually becomes mainstream?
I wish I could share. I mean, I can. Some of the anecdotes from Gods Unchained where people have literally earned, you know, hundreds of dollars per week through playing the game. And because it's a skill-based game, those are people who are winning competitive tournaments. And we have this incredible opportunity to actually translate human labor and gaming into value. And it's not empty, right? Like, this is really important because people say Ponzi schemes, all of this stuff. This money is not free. This money is a better way to market. This money is a better way to retain. This market is a better way to have players share via word of mouth. So fundamentally what we're doing is we're taking the $2 billion a major game, and this is literally the marketing budget would spend on Facebook and Google ads per year, taking that to zero, and instead spending that on building a meaningful economy where players can earn NFTs, where players can actually trade for real value. And because of that, they will share it with their friends. They will stick around much longer and they will spend more. And when you look at that core set of economics, it's literally just sharing value with players rather than paying some middleman for growth.
Yeah, fair enough. So what the industry, and this is kind of anecdotal, right, is lacking right now is mainstream game from an MMO RPG to RPGs that have actually incorporated NFTs. Do you see use cases for NFTs in games that don't have that online component to them, such as, you know, The Witcher 3?
I don't think NFTs make sense without a tradable economy, because they're about ownership and tradability at the end of the day. So generally where we're going to see this take off is in any experience where ownership is valuable, which means you can trade things.
Yeah. And how long do you think it will be until we actually see a mainstream game in general enter the market that incorporates NFTs? Or has it already happened?
I would say it has not happened. I mean, mainstream is big in gaming. It's like 50 million players. We have not seen that. It will definitely be this year. And the reason I say this is crypto is a unique industry, not that unique to tech. It's broadly kind of follows the tech's trend of capital will accelerate ahead of user adoption, but in line with VC predictions and expectations. And so what you see is in the giant wave of capital that came into the crypto industry in 2017 with the ICO boom, there are a bunch of scams, there are a bunch of shitty projects, things died down during the bear market. But what people don't know is that during that bear market, developers and building 10x, even though the capital went away. And that's because it came in the first place. In the same way, we've seen this massive rush into capital, but games that are good games actually take a while to build. They're like movies. They take 12 to 24 months. You know, we've been working on Gods Unchained for over 3 years. And so we're going to see a lot of games that started development a year ago that are much higher quality than what we see today come into the market. I think you'll stop seeing low quality games get crazy valuations, and generally the whole quality will equilibrate to be quite high quality. And gaming is hit driven. So out of these 10 things, one of them will become mainstream. That's absolutely our vision for Gods Unchained and for Guild of Guardians. It's a vision for every one of the games that we work with on our platform today. You have games like Alluvium or Planet Quest that have grown enormous audiences in such a short period of time.
Yeah. And how about for 3D ARPGs? What's your take on that?
Yeah. We are actually building one in-house. You may know of Guild of Guardians, which is built on Immutable. And the reason we did those is we wanted to have a flagship desktop game so people could, if they were building a desktop game, come and say, well, hey, this is how I'm going to build the best-in-class one using Immutable's technology. We also wanted to do one for mobile. So we say, you know, we've worked with the Apple Store, we've worked with the Android Store, we've ironed out all the kinks. Here's the playbook available to you so you can make it as simple as possible to build. So Guardians is a mobile RPG. And the entire goal is, again, not to sell shiny NFTs for hundreds of thousands of dollars. It's to create an in-game tradable economy that leverages digital asset ownership to build to tens of millions of players and then incentivize trading. And this is actually really cool, which is you have this brand new monetization system, which is clips on secondary trades. And the reason I love this is it's no longer, hey, I'm creating assets and then selling them to you and then you can do nothing with them. Because if I'm creating assets and selling them to you, my incentive is to keep as much control as possible. I want the only way to buy it is come to me. It's why Ticker Tech tries to lock down secondary ticket sales, because it undermines the primary issuer's value. But suddenly we see the ability to actually monetize via secondary market trades, which fundamentally aligns the incentives of a player with a publisher. because the publisher is incentivized to keep that game alive as long as possible, to keep the value of these assets going, and to also, if they make a new game, kind of translate those assets between. And so I am really, really excited to business models that don't even sell a cent to players. They simply take them on the ride, build an epic and awesome economy with them, and take clips off that as it grows. So the same incentives as end players.
Yeah, that's a really interesting product strategy. So in the back half of last year, we saw something interesting, which was Valve actually banning NFTs and games that use blockchain technology from Steam. Then you have on the other side, Epic, who says it's open to the idea. So we have two kind of giants in the industry taking opposite stances. What's your opinion on this? What do you say? Well, obviously we know what you said.
Yeah. And look, Microsoft tried to build a giant intranet when the internet was coming out so they could own it, right? Because they were the technology giant. It was called Microsoft Services Network. And had that one out, none of the progress made available by the information age would have happened, or it would have happened 10 or 20 years later, setting back humanity by that period of time. Not to call out Microsoft, every incumbent has done that, right? And this is the thing, is that people want to monopolize profits. People, if they are sitting in the king's seat, don't want to give it up. And it's scary for those incumbents to say, well, hey, here's a new business model. It can grow faster, it can do better for players, and it offers 10 times value. That's the fundamental kind of core conceit of disruption. I think it will be really interesting to see how the Epic Store carves out a niche in kind of contrast to this. And in general, you're seeing big wars here, right, between monopolistic aggregators or app stores and people who are trying to differentiate by offering much better sort of fees. I mean, Steam literally charges 30% like the Apple Store. That is nuts. Like 30% on a digital asset is absurd to be charging in today's day, but they can do it because it's a completely centralized and owned gray marketplace. They shut down anyone who becomes dangerous. Like they shut down Opskins, a $300 million business who later became Wax. So we will see disruptors rise off the back of countering kind of monopolistic companies, because that's the most powerful narrative to get around. I mean, that's why a lot of you are here today.
Yeah. Moving on to the more general usage of NFTs in general. And I think you touched on this before in regards to the cross-platform aspect, but could you actually delve into what the future of that cross-platform NFT access would look like?
Yeah, of course. So cross-platform is a given, right? Like NFTs can be used anywhere. So if you have games on two different platforms, say a PlayStation and a PC, it's going to make instant technological sense and eminent business sense for that to be cross-platform. I think the other really interesting question that this ties into is interoperability, which is, will you use the same asset in multiple games? And we have yet to see, I think, a strong business case or successful implementation of this. Right now, it's really just a bit of marketing hype. It's like, you know, two brands collaborating to kind of make everyone feel good and kind of share audiences. But I think we'll start to see really interesting business takes on it. And that's where you'll get the most sustainable progress, right? It's not about ideation. It's about, do you create better value for players? Can you create a faster growing business model? That's where real growth comes from and where industry trends to over time. And I think the value of interoperability is you can do what has been one of games companies' biggest banes, which is transferring audiences. I mean, look at someone like Supercell, who had massive, massive hits with things like Clash of Clans, but has, you know, struggled to translate those into future audiences. Now you can build a audience over time where, hey, here's a new IP. We're going to translate people from this old game to this old game. We're not throwing your assets away. We're keeping them valuable. And we've seen this paradigm become dominant in other areas. So if you look at the film industry today, the vast majority of big budget films are all IP-based. And the reason is they are way less risky. You are not risking it on some new superhero IP. You're using Marvel. You're not risking it on, you know, X. You're using The Matrix. They literally resurrected that thing from the dead, and it was awful. All because IP creates reliable, known audiences who want to participate. And everything is about reducing idiosyncratic risk. So I think that will be the key value to interoperability. And the nice thing is it's very much player-aligned and very much long-term community-aligned.
Yeah. And outside of gaming, sports memorabilia, what industries do you see NFTs being utilized in?
Yeah, literally everything. So I think I said this before, right? So NFTs, I break down into two categories. You have digital assets where the value of the item is literally digital. That could be a video game item. It could be a blockchain native insurance contract. There are companies building smart contracts that automatically pay you out if wind speeds in a certain area pick up above a certain amount and kind of like pay you, you know, hurricane rewards. Then I think we're also going to see the tokenization of real world stuff. And this is broadly broken down into, to get a bit technical, centralized registry products, looking at centralized IP as well, and also centralized finance. So things like, you know, options contracts, I mean, term deposits, they're literally the largest outstanding liability class in the world today. There's trillions of dollars worth of them, and you should be able to trade them. And being able to trade them would be much better to consumers because suddenly you've created an efficient global market for interest. And so it's going to take over everything. Like, tokenization is eating the world. It will be slow in some areas. Like, real estate's not going to happen for a decade because you've got to work with 4,000 different global jurisdictions in order to correlate the digital asset with the underlying title system of whatever house you're talking about. But it will get there.
Mm. Okay. So a community for NFTs currently exists. There's no surprise about that. But if I were to bring up this topic with my parents or my grandparents, they'd stare at me thinking I was speaking a different language. So how is Immutable X approaching getting non-tech savvy people on board for mass adoption?
Yeah. So if you come to Immutable X, any one of our supported marketplaces today, the goal of our protocol is to let them build the best possible NFT marketplace and experience as easily as possible. So any business built on us has access to our credit card on-ramp, so you can instantly buy crypto used to transact with credit cards. Soon we're going to have the ability for you to trade any asset directly with credit cards. We're building our, you know, partnerships with custodial wallet partners. So our platform is fully self-custodial, but if you want to onboard with a custodial wallet, you absolutely can. So it's about making it ridiculously easy for end users to use. And again, reducing this word NFT, like, you shouldn't have to tell your mum that she's earning a, if she does play RuneScape, I think it's rare, but she's earning an NFT party hat. Like, she should just be like, oh, awesome. Like, I can trade this stuff. Like, I don't explain that it is the property of physics that guarantees there's only one copy of your unique baseball card. You just know it intuitively because that's the rules that you are brought up in and the expectations that you have. And I think it's quite sad that somehow the digital world has been created with the expectation that you own none of it, probably because that technology wasn't possible in day one, but it's time to change that.
Yeah, I like the ethos of not having to mention NFT, and it should just exist there. That's a very good way to look at it. And yeah, scammers in this space haven't done the word NFT any justice, right? I think that's well known. So how do you respond to people who claim NFTs are a scammer's tool and have no compility, no utility compared to the existing processes?
Yeah, I often agree with them. There are heaps of scammers in the crypto space. Like, it is rife with them. I'm not going to disagree with that. But it's just a tool. It's how you use it. And I think art, some of the stuff that's coming out there is freaking awesome. Like, we've created digital art that has returned more wealth and value to content creators and art than literally ever before. And now we're going to do the exact same thing for gaming. We're going to take streamers who right now are literally paid on patronage, right? Donations. That's bloody absurd. It's literally the same system that bards were paid with in the 1800s by lords of the house. And we can replace it with a system that efficiently looks at how much value they're bringing to the underlying content. Like, the whole goal of Web3 is let people own the value they're creating in platforms rather than giving it to some giant business or some giant aggregator. And that's really the fundamental thing that we're trying to do in gaming.
All right, well, let's start to wrap up this, and let's end with a kind of big one. So where is Immutable in 10 years? Tell us that. What's the vision?
Yeah, as I said, the vision is first, win gaming, build the best possible platform for any game to come, build on us and trade on us on some of the premier venues in the world. And GameStop is, I think, incredibly well positioned to establish itself as the dominant NFT gaming aggregator or marketplace. So very excited there. The goal is then to take over every other vertical and make everything, every one of them, fairer, easier to trade, and empowering consumers while they do so. In general, the thesis of Immutable is, like, 2021 saw a whole bunch of luxury NFT trades, and they're cool. I have nothing against them. But the future of NFT trading lies in utility NFTs, reasons to trade things that have zero correlation to the crypto market. You don't buy them for speculative reasons. Like, in Gods Unchained, we have more NFTs than every other Ethereum game combined. And they trade for, on average, $2. And that means you have actually created a genuine economy. People buy it to win a tournament or win a game. That is the kind of sustainable utility-driven NFT use cases we're interested in. And we want to do that across the gaming vertical, across social media verticals, across art, and across finance.
Yeah. Well, let's end this on something we all have a shared passion for, which is gaming. What's your favorite gaming memory? Tell us.
So my favorite gaming memory is actually, this was a while ago, it was 8 years ago. I was playing in a Minecraft server. It was a, I forget the name, but one of those big kind of servers with real economies.
Mm.
And there was diamonds that had a certain price. I think it was say like $500. And you could buy or trade these diamonds via automated NPCs, but you had to fill the NPCs with the items and say, I'm going to sell them for this price. So there's a real kind of economy built in this Minecraft game. And I remember one day just walking for hours just in one direction of this world. I don't know why I did it. I was just traveling, but I found a very old ruins of a town from like a few months ago in the server's past. And there had been massive inflation in the diamond market since then. So the diamonds there were like, you could buy them for $5 and you know, sell them for $4. So like the spread was very thin, the price is very low, and there was a ton of supply. So I literally bought like 1,000 diamonds for $5, went and sold it back in the modern world, like whatever kilometers away for the right price, and then kept doing that and arbed it out. And then I bought a house off a player, and then I immediately quit because I was like satisfied with the world. But that's definitely my favorite gaming experience.
Awesome, good to hear. On that note, I just want to say thanks for your time. We'll wrap it up there. Really appreciate it. Thanks, Robbie.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Jack.